because lots of people have said when they see these videos, like in Nottingham and like here last time, they've got no idea whether there's three or four sitting there or I'm doing it on my own. So I thought what a good idea might be is just to start showing that people are coming in greater numbers. So if everybody's okay with that.
Happy.
I normally charge people for free to pay, right?
Is that enough of a contract?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Thanks again for coming along to Ashton-in-Makerfield. Always welcome to come along every Wednesday evening we meet here. Always welcome here. Don't sit at home. Don't feel you're sitting at home and you're the only nurse at the bottom of the street. There's thousands of us, you know. Please join in every Wednesday, 8 o'clock here. So, hand over to Peter again. Thank you very much, Peter, for your time.
Okay, thank you very much, first of all, for coming today. An amazing number, and the meetings are growing all the time. Right, so what I'd like to do just before I begin is to give people a very brief overview of sort of where we've come today, or to date, and just to explain some of the things that have happened today. We started the first run on the checkbooks around about, I think it was April the 13th. So we're not far now, coming up to our sort of second month, and we're still going, and it's getting stronger. The number of people that are joining at the moment, it's averaging probably around 65 people a day that are coming on. 2 weeks ago, that was 45 to 50, so it's creeping up steadily. The thing that's holding us up at the moment is that before, there was a lot of activity from overseas because people could not only join, but they could pay. And there does seem to be a very, very strong link in this, for some reason, that people do actually want to contribute. So with the pay point sort of saga playing out as it did, a lot of people are, I think, being frustrated in places like Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and the United States, because they just can't join. And so there's a little bit of drop off for that. So at the moment, the people who are coming on board, around about 70% are coming from the UK. Canada then probably makes up another 5 to 10%, and then the rest is from other places around the globe. The idea was that after the saga with PayPal, who still have not allowed us access to the account and won't even allow us to make refunds, is that we had to look for another platform, or to try and look for another platform so people could pay, so that we could start to, or join, so we could actually start expanding the base and the facilities that we were offering. So we looked at an organization, it's an Indian organization originally, operating also in Canada, and that was called Patronics. It didn't work out because we actually found that one of their organizations, I think, who'd been dealing with them, had actually been closed down, I think, through a dispute with Visa or whatever. So the problem is, we didn't really want to be jumping out of the frying pan into the fire, and then in a few weeks' time being able to say to everybody, well, hey, you know, the same things happened again. So what we had to do is to start looking to alternative means and alternative ways of funding us. So when we were at the Nottingham meeting last time, what we did is, for those people who wanted to join there and then, we offered a facility whereby we pass envelopes around, and on the envelopes they had to put on, so just in case people want to do that again today here, they had to put their name, their email, their address, and also what they're actually wanting. Is it a £10 membership on a monthly basis? Is it £10 in for 2 months membership? Or is it for the checkbook and a month's membership, or whatever combination that might be? So if everybody's reasonably clear on that, that's for the people at the meetings. So what we're trying to do then is have more meetings, because the integrity of the meeting is the key that the elite no longer want to have us doing. And this is why we're living in quite a disconnected society, where it's very easy to make contributions via PayPal. It's very good to like things on Facebook. But the only thing that's going to change anything is people getting off their backsides, coming together. And the whole ideology behind WeRe Bank was always to restore the fabric or the glue of society which held us all together. And that only comes with shaking people's hands, sitting next to them, getting into difficulties collectively, but sorting them out collectively too. Otherwise, where we're heading for very quickly, and you might have seen it on one of the most recent Alex Jones broadcasts, but he was quite a reliable economist that he was talking to. I think his name, Harry Dent. And he's talking about the collapse in the United States Treasury short-term market and also what's called the 10-year market, where the money, the returns on these bonds now are hysterically at almost at zero. They used to be at a premium of around 2 to 4%. And that also ties in with the fact that the global banking elite have recently had this meeting in London, and it's for the next phase of the New World Order agenda, which is a cashless society. So for those who haven't heard before, I think in Denmark from 2016, the retailers have the option of opting out and not accepting cash. And then in Europe, provisionally from beginning of 2018, maybe January, then only small denominational bills will be accepted for things like ice cream, bread, maybe giving to someone, I don't know, on the street. So that's why we've got this what do they call it, this system now, proximity pay. Yeah, with your cards, you don't even have to put it in now. It doesn't do the dial-up. It gets you through real quick because it isn't dialing in. It's simply clearing it, and they'll come for the money if you go into debit later. So this is really what the focus of today is. And it's a very important meeting, this one, because it's the first time I've been able to bring some of the ideas that I had originally in 2012 and bring them up to date here, and they're coming to the fore now because, in my opinion, we're drastically running out of time. And so the message has always been, we need to get these groups going in Birmingham and in Nottingham and here in Aston and in Liverpool and in Manchester and then down the south and north of the border, wherever we can get them going. And so this is very critical. After the meeting today, if you want, you can suggest having a meeting. So instead of these people coming up from London, or some people came from Southport recently, then you just get the meeting focused in a venue, and then I'll come down and then we'll grow it from there, because we've got to get these hubs up and running. We've got a commitment from the group here. We've got some people in Liverpool who are creating it now, and it's a real dynamic, because what you are to me is my protection, because without you this doesn't go anywhere with me. Because lots of people are saying, oh, I'm surprised it's still going, and I hear you've been arrested again, and there's all these, you know, the Metropolitan Police and the fraud squad are looking at it, and, well, they can, but I've said consistently, the last place they want me is in a court of law talking about this. So, you know, there's various things that we can do if they try and push it to that level, but what we'll have them doing is systematically dismantling their entire edifice of their financial, commercial, criminal structure in front of whoever's there. Otherwise, they're going to have it as a trial in secret, and, you know, we are then very much into, a Stalinist sort of dictatorship whereby there is no rule. There is actually no rule of law anyway. For all the people who know here, you're going to stand in a court. It doesn't matter whether you had Jesus, Gandhi and Buddha there as your defense. They'll just ignore it. They'll steamroller it through. And at the end of the day, everybody's standing around and saying, well, why didn't he even listen? So the constitutional background here, it is not government now by consent. it's an electoral or a democrat, well, not a democratic, it's an electoral dictatorship that you've been scooped up in, where the semblance of a democratic vote then gets lost in the cabinet office. The cabinet office makes the rules. The cabinet office is not a constitutionally recognized organism. It's somewhere where Cameron sits with 12 knights of sort of the round table making collective commercial decisions that affect your life. So people say, oh, well, if you don't vote, it doesn't get you anywhere. If you do vote, it doesn't get you anywhere. But equally, they're laughing up their cuffs at you, because these decisions are made by a small coterie of individuals, and constitutionally, they have no weight over you, because if you look at what a definition of statute law was in Black's Dictionary or any dictionaries prior to probably 1970 or 80, it will say that a statute is primarily there and allowed to run with the consent of the people. So if you haven't consented to it, then you should object to it. And all this confetti of statutory instruments, you know, for parking and bylaws and the cameras which regulate you to 50 miles an hour as average speed, it's not constitutional and it's not an act of parliament. And what we've got to start doing is bringing that message to the fore with everybody we deal with. And the only way we can do this really is making these groups bigger, because with big comes acknowledgement. If they stay at these numbers, then it will be a nice memory that, you know, we were involved in that in 2015, and what a shame that one didn't work as well. So the only way we can move this is by you, every time, wherever these meetings are, put your egos in your pocket or your pride, but drag someone along. And if the message isn't good, it will just die on the, you know, the fruit will die on the tree. But the very fact that these numbers are coming together are different than every meeting that I can see of for many years around, because people are travelling in from quite considerable distances just to be there. There's the next meeting on the 20th in Birmingham. Already there's around about 100, 120 provisionally booked in for there. So what I'm saying is it's a time to be excited and to get excited. And so now what I'm going to do, having covered that, is the road ahead. I'm not going to touch on all the stuff I've usually covered before in these lengthy 2.5-3 hour videos, which the video editors are very glad for me not to be doing, because now I've said all of that, and you know, nobody's going to come to these meetings and hear the same thing twice, apart from the consistent drumbeat that we are running out of time. That's not a fear generator. That's not to say you need to panic, but you need to be intelligent. You need to be discerning. You need to stop listening to what's being, force-fed onto you. Look at all the stuff that's coming from the media and dismiss it wholeheartedly. And then start thinking, right, do any of these things that we're talking about make sense? And if they do, well, let's go with it, because I promise I'm not some sort of bizarre Pied Piper leading you into a life of ruination. What's out there is not what you want, and where we want to go together is hopefully where we go. So we won't touch on any of these other general subjects, but the title today, Free Movement and WeRe Bank, The Road Ahead. So what does the road ahead, because it's such a warm day, we'll take a few minutes break, and that'll give us time then to set up the projector, and then we'll go again. So that's a good cue, because someone's phone's just gone off. So we'll just take a very short break now, and then we'll be back right after this. Okay, so to resume, someone has just asked a question about, he's received a checkbook and his wife has applied or hasn't received her checkbook. Can he sign a check on her behalf, or can she take the check and sign it? No, it's only the cheque numbers are listed against the person that actually applied and joined. And so if that comes through on the system and the cheque number is always quoted, and then we see a different name against it, then we would have to say, well, excuse me, we need to look into that. So then that causes a bit of a repercussions along the,
okay,
you know,
please.
The clearing. So, on that topic now, and we'll clear up some of this before we get onto the presentation main, I'm going to try and go through this in about 40 minutes. So just so that you know, usually these presentations have a habit of me going on too long. So I'm going to start cutting it down and making it a lot more intricate. But it's going to get a little technical, because without the technicals in it, then this is just a bit of a, you know, a bit of a waltz around the park, and the powers that might be looking at it will think it's all just you know, it's all just a fantasy of somebody's deranged imagination. Let's address the fact that certain people are having checks returned to them by public utilities companies, Virgin Media, Sky, a district council, whether it's Wigan District Council or Southend District Council. Are there any people here in that? I'm sure there's one or two. Yeah? Okay. So, not so many. Right. However, it is happening, and it does happen. It does happen. So, if you go onto the frequently asked questions section on WeRebank.com, you'll actually see us addressing some of these points. Some of them, for example, it's a rubber check, the bank isn't legitimate, it's not incorporated, it's not regulated by the FSA, etc., etc. The big one on the legitimacy is you actually have to look at what various judges have said in the past and what the nature of banking is. Even the Bills of Exchange Act defines it as an organisation, incorporated or not, that is in the business of doing certain things. And if you do these certain things, you are deemed to be banking. There's even cases where the so-called law lords in the past have adjudicated that small enterprises who were not in the nature of banking were engaged in banking. So as far as that argument is concerned, it's for us to be defining banking, not for some teller clerk sitting on a nice swivel chair in HSBC's head office saying what it is and what it isn't. If they want to argue the toss on that, then we can argue that in a court of law, okay? Because it's a very salient point. The next thing is the account number. I had Cambridge Magistrates Court on the phone on Friday. They were concerned about the account number. It's a series of eights. Yes, it is. It's a trust account. So if you've got any questions on the nature of that, it's a series of eights because it's an account number for all of you. And you're all in a club. And in effect, what you've done with your £10 a month, you've created your own bank. Yeah? So all we've done is facilitated that and then opened up a slight, instead of a two-dimensional game of tennis between the plaintiff's barrister, the judge, and you, we've actually done something and said, right, well, let's put another party in, we'll create a triangle, and so now what we've done is immediately energetically distanced you from the confrontation with them. So your protection then is in the realm of, what do I have here? What is the nature of commerce? What's the nature of a promise? And is it legal? Look up and start to learn and educate yourself. What is the definition of money? Yeah? Oh, now they say for some of the council, sorry, we only take credit card. We won't take cheque, we won't take cash, we won't take gold or silver, we won't take share certificates, they'll take nothing. Next they'll be telling you to pay in pineapples, or blood, or whatever else suits them. And so, this is the problem. This is where it's going. The cashless society that they want is no consultation from you, yeah? The so-called democracy of all democracies, the mother of democracy here, no consultation, no whether you want it or not, it's continuously forced down your gagging throat, and it's got to stop. And you are the people who are going to stop it. So I can help you and show you the way, but we have to do it together. And as I said before the break, you are my protection. So all I'm bringing to you now is an idea. And it's something I'm going to touch on now, because if you look at the world we live in a world of ideas. It's nothing more. And it's all been made up on the hoof, and it's all been changed as we go along. Except you're not the ones changing it. You're there in a very, very passive role with this social engineering and eugenics masquerade of for your safety and security wound around you as, you know, the net gets tighter, your liberties become fewer, and eventually when the catch drops, you know, we're all going to be on the wrong side of the wrong room. So apart from that, I don't really have too much of an opinion on it. And so now what we're going to do is to move on. Nope, just before we do that, I haven't finished what I was going to cover. This is for all the people who say the banks have ostracized us and not communicating with us. Here on National Westminster Bank letterhead from the manager, High Street in Egham, is a cheque of ours. Okay, for the benefit of the audience. And it's for 1,093 spot 64. And they've had the presence of mind to not bother what UK Clearing says, not to bother what CCC, that's the cheque and card clearing company, says. They've actually sent it through to us for clearing. Now, I can't, but there's lots of examples of this. So what we have here is to the manager of WeRe Bank. Okay? It's come from the manager of NatWest Bank, Egham. Sorry about this, pal, if you lose your job, come and work for us. 50 High Street. It's got advice of a special presentation check. This is what you should, if any of these so-called payees say it's been bounced back by their bank because the sort code's not recognised. Well, of course it's not recognised because we're not involved in their criminal, mafia, monarchical country club. We're outside of it. And when they say it's not a legitimate bank, they've got that damn right. Because the legitimate banks are involved in money laundering, funding wars of aggression, genocide, funding all military operations around the planet, funding the drug cartels, because with everyone that's doing the paying, somebody's got to be doing the buying, and what are they saying? It isn't going through the banks. So for every shell that hits a wall in Palestine, or every shell from a Kalashnikov that tumbles onto the ground in Rwanda with some child's head blown open, those fat arses of the people sitting in those high street banks telling you that you can't do this, when they're actively propping up an organization involved in criminal acts, genocide, war of aggression, torture, etc., etc., they need it sort of gently bringing home to them, because this is quite passionate and it's very serious. Yeah? Okay. So here we have the drawer, that's the name on the check. We have the individual who's then got the check number. We have a sort code on it. We have an address. It came to us. Wasn't so difficult. Came in the post. It says the amount being under 500,000, do this with it. Or the amount being, either under 500,000 or below. This is what you need to do. It's got a signature on it, is quite good, and then it's got the instructions of what they want us to do with it. So if you can't do it any of these ways, Then they've even put a bank gyro credit on the bottom for us to do that. And if you look at some of the things that like Wesley Ahmed has done with paying British Gas with a bank gyro credit and what it means when you put a signature on it, in effect what they've done is they've sent you a check. Okay, so that's just to let you know that. And that's not, I brought one along because I could have brought many, but NatWest's a good one. Another one here, from Sedgemoor in Somerset, Finance, Property and Exchequer Team. Again, copy of the cheque with the allonge, with instructions, how to pay. It's got WeRe Bank stamp on it, says WeRe Bank received, funds cleared. Okay, another one here, Hewlett Packard from Crawley, requires immediate action. Check on the back, instructing us how they want it to be paid. For our international friends out there, various checks come in. From this one's from Scotiabank in Hamilton. I think that's Ontario. So again, instructions with the check on how to pay it. And these are coming in under what's called advice of a special presentation. So these people in Canada have had to keep pushing and arguing, no, you're obliged to clear it. And they've come back and made all sorts of excuses. No, we can only accept Canadian currency from a Canadian bank. Don't. Go and look at what it actually says in the international treaties. So you have to man up a little bit with these people who were saying, sorry, no, we're not going to clear it. If they are making accusations against WeRe Bank, if they're making accusations that the checks are fraudulent or the account number doesn't exist or you're in danger of being involved in a scam, then volunteer to help them get you to expose it. Yeah? And why we look at that is it's an old trick of tort. Laws of tort, of trespass, and various other tortuous actions from the 16th and 17th century particularly. And what the rationale is as follows. If that individual is claiming a particular state of affairs, and you then become the plaintiff, the idea is you call him as a witness for you. If he refuses, he then has to be put as a witness for us, because he can't have it both ways. Yeah? And if he refuses, and he has what's called a reasonable degree of knowledge within his station, then it looks like perversion of the course of justice, or he's deliberately fogging the issue. So this is why we're trying to do this. If they're making these accusations, fine. Three or four lines explaining why, and lots of lies are coming that they try to present it, but we've turned it down. Just for the record, the phone only gets answered by one person, that's me. There's no one else turning it down. There's no one else answering it after 7 o'clock at night. Good cue. Might be for me. It's not my phone, by the way. So it's a point here that will come on more and more as we step through this, that these people who are telling you the way it is are just low-level counter staff who are paid to just do whatever. And the main thing is they need to be put on the spot and made to realize what they're actually protecting, what they're upholding, and the sheer criminality and the degree of deceit within these, you know, these moth-ridden fossil structures that have been keeping us in this state of war forevermore. So this takes us on now to the very next pertinent point, is war. Because this is the agenda of this planet and always has been. War is the norm. That's where the bankers make the money and historically always have. And they fund both sides of the conflict. And the agreement is that whoever is the victor picks up the bill for the reconstruction. Okay, so that's the deal. That's how they play it. That's how they never lose. And so when these dictators or these individuals are coming to power and they need money to fund everything, Who pays for the bullets? Who clears the checks? That is your beautiful send it by Swift, or BACS, or CHAPS. That's what they are. Illegal money laundering rat runs, electronically set up, so these creeps can hide all their financial dealings for the Hillary Clintons and the Bushes and the Blairs and the Camerons under the carpet where no one can see it. Yeah? And then they expect us to play games with them as well. But that's the thing. So that's why we're out of their operational circle. That's why we're not involved with UK clearing. That's why we're not involved with any of these country club organizations like the private company or the Bank of England or the FSA or Prudential Regulatory Authority, whatever the damn they call themselves now. We're just not involved in it because we don't do it their way. We do it differently. Right, so here, what we've got here, we're going to look at certain things now within the compass of WeRe Bank, which is all based around the potential, and I think quite real situation, that very soon you're going to be in a cashless society and you're always going to be in danger of having the carpet taken from under your feet. Because if they don't like who you're associating with or the meetings you're coming or going to, then next thing you know, your internet link is switched off, your credit card's sort of limited to 150 a month for food, etc. And don't think they won't do it, because if you join the dots from where we've come and you project it into the future, you don't really have to be, you know, terribly clued up to see where they want to take it. So until you actually see some type of regime change there, and that means people like Cameron out of the way, people like Obama out of the way, Hollande in France, Merkel in Germany, until you see some change there, then it's the agenda as it is, and they're very confident that they're going to be able to push it through. So what we've looked here at, something in the past, we see this price stability here. 1717 to 1914, the price of gold remained static. Sir Isaac Newton, who was the master of the Royal Mint, set the price in 1717 at £3, 17 shillings and 10 pence. And I can see most of you in here remember actually that type of currency. Okay, so what we had is, that's for 1 troy ounce, and it stayed that price from 1717 to about, actually a bit further than 1914, but in principle, over just about 200 years, where if you'd have gone back in time with an ounce of gold in your pocket, you could have lived in 1717 and before as easily as you could after. How could that happen for 200 years and more? And then the Federal Reserve Act 1913 comes in and bang, we have a war, which propels us into a cycle now of economic and social and spiritual and moral collapse that we probably even never really came out of. It was a shock. So price stability not good. Lies in freight, inflation, interest, taxation are all sold to you as being part of the business cycle. But they're not. They're manufactured in rooms by senior economists for bankers who tell you that's the way it is and it's free play of market forces. It's not, because it's evidenced by the fact that when things get very dodgy in global economic theatres of war, prices of gold usually go up because it's a safe haven. It doesn't happen. The stock markets are all-time high, and it's completely disconnected, probably from about 2000, I would say. So the devaluation of the money supply keeps you as a rat on the wheel, and you've got to keep earning more, because if you try and retire at 50 with what you calculated as being enough, 15 years later, you find out a cup of coffee is now 100 quid and you're in trouble. The quantitative easing fiasco is basically counterfeiting currency. All this money they're pumping in the United States, it was 30 billion. Now over here in Europe, it's It's 1.2 trillion over the next year and a half by the European Central Bank. So credit is this thing called negative capacitance. It's an electrical thing, and how they spark it or free it off is invariably through war. So that's just a run on this. So devaluation of wealth. I'm only covering this generally today because it's something that is going to be quite important in a moment. 1717, the population of the UK was around about 9.6 million. And that's England, Scotland, Ireland, and Wales. The little sub numbers just there. You see? These bits here. 1717, the price of gold at £3.17 and 10. Today, there's 64 million in, and we've had a sevenfold increase. So it's around about 725 a troy ounce. Okay? So, yeah, it's a bit sort of heavy here, but there's this thing called gross domestic product, GDP, per capita, UK in 1717. Was around about £6.60 or £6.6, equivalent to 1.7 ounces of gold. Today we've got a GDP per capita in the UK of about 25,000. Okay? But equals to about 35 ounces. So there's a 2,000% increase on those figures. That one divided by 3.5 ounce minus 1.7 ounce divided by 1.7 gives about a 2,000% increase. So therefore we've got here 35 divided by 1.7, so the current value of an ounce of gold, if it was based on this GDP, should be around 15,000 a troy ounce. Now lots of people in there, we've got to be carefully, because lots of people are on this gold bug thing, and people talk about silver and gold and what's its worth and who's suppressing it and how much really is there. But we're just equating this here, that these points here are factual. You see, this cost here for 200 years was maintainable, and that was including through the Industrial Revolution. So all the people who say, ah, well, it's different now because we've got technology now and we've got Audis and we've got planes and we fly all around the world. Look at the biggest expansion of any country, the British Empire, through a time of Industrial Revolution, through the 1800s, 1850, 1860, even into, say, 1895 when Tesla discovered his AC/DC system for electrification. Phenomenal. And gold stayed the same. If you want to go in and look at historical prices on almost anything, oil and bread and orange juice, it was all fairly constant. So all I'm trying to make you realize is the trick that they've pulled over is a big trick, and it doesn't have to be like that. But it serves them to have you believe it has to be like that. Okay, so where does it lead us? So we've had over 300 years a 186-fold increase in the price of gold and seven times a population increase. So what we're looking at is the structure now for WeRe Bank as it's going to go forward. As everybody knows, we have some fundamental aspects to it. We've got the unit of currency, which is the RE, which is pegged to time, and we also have the promissory note, which is the world that we are trying to sort of detach ourselves from. And the reason that the promissory notes are based in sterling and in RE is that we've got two currencies stepping or going complementarily down the road together. But so the key to this financial stability is one RE, that's one RE, or it could be $1 or £1, but backed by something of value. And this is always historically what it was. It was either backed by silver, it was backed by gold, it was backed by a combination. And this is where the ruling elite, when they collapse the market, before they get onto these things called SDRs, or special drawing rights, which is just more ways of magicking up money, they're looking for a gold-backed currency to convince all of you to probably subscribe or buy into. Because when the confetti is no longer, should we say, worth anything, or when they've collapsed it, they want to take you maybe down that road. So, planetary collateral reserves and this prepaid treasury. This is like where all the elite's store is. There's two different accounting systems, really. There's the one that the world seems to present to you, and a bit like in The Matrix when Morpheus speaks to Neo, then there's what's actually behind the scene and how reality for them really is. The gold price is pegged to protect the elite from two main areas of attack. So what we're looking at here is, can we use gold as a means of protecting you and everyone else that comes in over time? So physical gold is invariably what's called 99.9% pure. The translation of this from the old into the new is always historically, it's the size of what you could carry was probably the limiting factor of commerce. You either had to go down to dust, you know, to have tiny particles, or you had to have a particle sufficient size that it was probably handleable, okay? Because they didn't have plastics, they didn't have the paper technology. And what we're looking at here is there anything we can do with modern gold, with technology and time, to sort out this coin size problem? Okay, so the ideas from the past could maybe float us today. So if the price of gold, and we can show it, so it doesn't really matter what the official version out there in Orwellian speak is, it's what we can see that it used to be at and what it possibly is projected at now. So what that would involve is a revaluation. So imagine somebody getting a balloon and weighting it down with concrete on the bottom of the seabed. What we're coming along and doing is cutting the cord and allowing it to refloat. Okay? So it's commonly spoken about. Currencies have this done with them regularly. In the inverse as well. For example, in the 80s, the Italians devalued their currency, the lira, because it was into the fact that you were using hundreds of thousands of lira just to buy a loaf of bread. Same as happened in Germany in the 1920s. So, this price of gold here, the New York Stock Exchange, or Metals Exchange, it's priced on infinite supply and futures contracts with no physical delivery. So when people quote you the price of gold, that's just based on that. If you have enough money and want to try and take physical delivery, then you have to go to the London Bullion Exchange and seek it there. And you'll find it isn't available. It's available in smaller amounts, but if you went into any meaningful amounts, then you'll find it's not available because you want physical delivery. And everyone that's really talked about gold in the past, and is there any people here who've read any of the forums of gold bugs and things like this? Anyone followed it? Maybe? Yeah? Shout out.
Yeah.
Don't be shy. Okay. And what they've all come a cropper on, a bit like Bitcoin, it being electronic, it got closed down for a while, the FBI seized the Bitcoins, or with Kitco, a gold trading organization, they volunteer to look after the gold for you, or you don't take physical delivery yourself, and then, you know, they get accused of not paying VAT on it, or whatever the scam is, and it all ends up causing very bad press. But what we're looking at here now is this thing here, the principle of a dollar or a re or anything. What does it mean? Can people read that at the back? Okay. So what, and this is written by a guy called Carl Denninger, who writes for, he runs a site called Market Ticker in the US. One of the best commentators on what's called capital markets. Indulge me while I just read it. $1 of capital is simply the principle that nobody be permitted to create credit out of thin air, thus artificially expanding the spendable supply of money in the system. This and only this is the reason for all the bubbles and financial collapses throughout history. This sleight of hand is why tulip mania in 1637 happened. It's why we had the crash in 1873, 1929. It's why the tech market blew in 2000. And it's why we had a crash in 2008 in the housing market. It's why we're threatened with a collapse in Europe right now. It's a scam as old as the money changers during the time of Hammurabi. And until we stop it, there will never be stability in the banking or financial system. The sleight of hand is in fact exactly identical in mathematical and economic impact to counterfeiting of the nation's currency. So don't let them point at you. You're not counterfeiting. You've actually done what every sane and morally obligated individual would do. You create a promise to do something, and with the value of that promise, engage in spending it down with everything that requires for you to repay it. But what they've done is completely sold you on the idea that they're lending you something when they're not. And the moment you sign, as I keep repeatedly saying, this Q1 2014 Bank of England report states that the moment the individual or the bank creates the loan, it creates a simultaneous deposit in the hands of the borrower. So what they're trying to do now is they're trying to make the clown car without the wheels go down the road forever by saying, well, you don't need money before you create a loan, you just create it and then that's there. The only problem with that is you're on the wrong end of the mathematics. You've got to do the paying of it back. So it's very easy for them to hit the keys, but what that then does is provide you with a lifetime of financial slavery and energy theft where you've got to pay it back. So, just to finish him off, a crime which we all should recognise, condemn, and when it occurs, the punishment should include both imprisonment and forfeiture of every dollar of ill-gotten gain. How are we doing for time, by the way? Can someone tell me? What I'd like to cover now is this this realm of ideas. Because everything in the world is an idea. Yeah? The idea of someone making this chair. The idea of Steve Jobs with his Apple computers. The idea of how we do our buildings, how we educate our children, the internet laws, how we elect our governments, how we educate our children. It's all ideas. Okay? And ideas only increase by being given away. So, if I've got a joke, funny joke, and I give it to you, and then you give it away because you think it's a real funny joke, it increases because more people take up on it. This idea that we're running with now, the idea of WeRe Bank, it's an idea, nothing more. And we can create it and move it and cut it however we wish. And if the idea is attractive, other minds take it up and we increase with it. And what we've got to do is we've got to get to critical mass. And critical mass in this population of 64 million isn't 30 million. It's probably not even a million. If we could get 10,000 people on board with this who were seriously committed to it, and it's not difficult because what we're offering is the keys to the cage and a way out. And don't forget, for every check that's turned down, and at the moment, God, there's probably 15,000 out there, that's 15,000 units of work energy that someone's got to argue the toss against you, or if they want and you insist, you've got to end up in a magistrate's court with. So can you imagine, yeah? So there are many functions behind WeRe Bank. Some of them are genuinely based on the fact of the legitimacy of the promissory note and who you are and restoring some of your sovereignty. But equally, there are other agendas within it which are like sort of like little exploding toys that are going off in these banks and in the courtrooms and wherever for a considerable period of time. We could actually probably formulate that we've already got there, you know, we've done what we needed to do, because I maintain that the genie's already out the bottle. Because once this is running and once people can see what can be done, and the fact that checks do get cleared by some, and other times, well, I don't know, they're too lazy to get in touch, or they just blatantly lie and say they've got in touch with us and we've refused to clear them. So they're lies. And it's up to you people out there and the people on the video watching to actually start putting pressure on them to prove that they're lying. Yeah? Because this is where it needs to go. And so what you've all been given is, you know, people say the pen is mightier than the sword. We don't want people on the street. We don't want people smashing windows. We don't need any aggression against the police. We just do it with a pen. But we stick with it. And when they come back and say it's not valid, well, you justify why it's not valid, and these are the points of why it is. Okay, so that's where we need to keep taking it. Right. This is a proposal. Now, I've spoken with some people at Get Out of Debt, and I've spoken with one or two other people in and around. Some people think this sort of cashless society is going to come sooner rather than later. I think inevitably, the way it's going, with local councils saying, you know, they won't take checks now, or checks are dangerous. Yeah, they'll only take a credit card. So what happens if you haven't got a credit card? You have to go to your local bank and have to fill in a lot of forms now, almost, to take out cash. Or there's a limit to how much you can take, or you've got to give them notice. And soon there won't be, because the limits in Europe are coming down. And even now, to cross borders in Europe, if you're taking more than 10,000 euros, you have to declare it through customs, or it's liable to be confiscated. So we need to get back to this community of dealing with ourselves in a way that's got some meaning. And the mindset of disconnection is a disconnection from everything. So it's a bovine sort of dumbing down of the population so that you just unwittingly almost just accept everything and nothing really has a price anymore. So this is really what I'm saying here, that the idea that I'm bringing here today is just an idea, and it's always a two-way street with an idea. I can give that to you, or we can work it together, but it's whether it makes sense as to whether it works or not. So, and this is also really designed so that people understand it's organic. There's a lot of thinking gone into it. We do have very, very concerned members of the establishment that are hoping it works. Yeah, so that's all I can say. Plus, I have to keep maintaining that the only thing that's going to get you through this is an identification with an energy force that's not only encoded in the cube sphere on the WeRe Bank. Yeah, everybody seen it? Everybody knows what it stands for?
No.
How many people don't know? Everyone. Okay. There are two main components of this, and they're very, very ancient. And we're using the technology, or should we say, the magic that the other side have systematically used in the past to weave a web around you and keep you in a state of, almost like hypno-trance. So, the cube and the sphere represent great spirit or consciousness or God or mind of Buddha, whatever your idea of a central unifying force is, but in space and time. So the dark cube represents the infinite expansion of coal black space, and the circle, the absolute compression into white hot suns of matter. So it represents the in-breath and the out-breath of everything in the universe. Because you breathe, the atoms vibrate, the birds breathe, the planet breathes, the trees breathe, the universe is expanding, and we're told eventually one day it's going to contract in on itself, maybe. But that's the fact. So that's what it represents, God. So if it's doable, then we have a God product on every single thing that we touch. So that's what the battle's about. You could say it's biblical, or you could say it's as old as time itself. And for those who've got a spiritual or a religious bent, you could say this is a way of finding out who you are. And for those who are atheistic or agnostic, it doesn't really matter. It's just nice symbols, and it might work. So that's for that. So the next part then is the re-symbol itself, which is, who knows what that is? Hands up for anyone who knows or doesn't know what the R and the E on the website, you know, or on the...
Egyptian, is it?
Okay, so these are runes. Okay. Has anybody heard of runes?
Yes.
Okay, the expression "you've been ruined" comes from
ruining.
So this is what we're trying to do, or will be doing, to them. Runes have historically been used by Charlemagne the Great, who became emperor of the Holy Roman Empire in 800, vanquished all his foes. The Holy Roman Empire was built around the use of so-called mythological energies, from Charlemagne through the Knights of the Holy Grail, right the way back through the Essene Brotherhood, which Jesus was involved with, etc. So the Gnostic sects and all of this. So what we've actually got here is two runes combined. The one that looks like the R is the fifth rune, called Rido, and that symbolizes the nature of cycles and the turning and the reward for work well done. So that's a cyclical revolutionary one. And then the little leg that's put on it represents a rune called Tiawaz, which is the 16th rune, and it symbolizes Tuesday, Tiawaz Day. And Tiawaz was one of the pantheon of gods, with Odin and Ingawaz, and people have sort of some mythological stuff recently. Loki, one of them in these things. And what he did, Tiawaz, it's a rune of supreme victory or sacrifice. And so he sacrificed his hand into the mouth of the wolf called Fenris to allow the gods to escape. So it's a bind rune. Bind runes, Nokia phone. Have a look at the K on Nokia. You'll see that the sixth rune Kenaz is not attached to the upright. Also Bluetooth, 18th rune Bacano, also used there. So they use a lot of these, this ideology or symbology. Okay, so that's really just to cover the tools we are bringing to what we're doing. This isn't some harebrained fantasy that's just come out of someone's kitchen after he'd had too many Stellas. It's been thought out hard and long, and these symbols and these objects, plus what everything is that's behind it, has been brought down to try and help you and me get out of this insane asylum that we're all locked in, which becomes more insane by the day, you know? So what we're looking at here then, these are the specifics on what I'm calling this route map or road ahead that we need to look at. So we've got to act now. We've got to start doing something now, and this is why these meetings are so important. And I thank everybody that's come over these distances today. People from Birmingham, and people come up from London, and people come from Yorkshire, all over the place. And this is what we've got to do. I made a prediction. As long as you can support me, before the end of the year, they'll be in football stadia, and we'll have 60,000 in the stadium. And nobody will be telling us. And nobody will be telling us we can and can't use the stadium or whatever the regulations are. We will be a serious, contentious force. And I made these declarations in 2012 and 2013 on YouTube. Then 2013, on the anniversary of when England was handed over to the Pope, to the papal legate called Pandolf, that I was taking it back on behalf of the people. So what we're doing is we're polarizing the country. It's called a polarity principle. So you've got to now invoke what's called catalyst. Otherwise people will never make a decision. So you're either with it or you're against it. If you're against it, that's fine, but we can see then who you are. Yeah. So this is why this campaign is going to run out, and we're going to be doing an identifying mark, the RE logo, which you can put into your car sticker, your car windscreen. Take the tax discs off, and they're going in where the tax disc used to be. We're going to have them on windows. We're going to have them everywhere that we can possibly. So we're marching it forward. It's going to be streetwear. And why we're doing this is for simple reasons. I know what the energetic charge of the symbol is. You will too, on various levels. Some on a conscious level, some on a subconscious level, some on a, well, I don't know, I just turned up because he asked me. But what we've got to get away from is getting into this argumentative, this is the statue, I'm at the side of the road, the cop's got the baton, I've got nothing, he wants to do whatever he wants to do to me. Or you're discussing something in a courtroom. You don't have to say anything. We just wanted, so when they see who you are or what's representing you, they immediately understand, oh right, okay, I can see where this is not going today. So we don't want to get into making it too difficult for you, not to make you all economists, or you don't have to know about the banking regulations. It's the fact that you're within a brotherhood, or in South America, and they call it Hermandad, or Hermandad. So it's like a collective. So it's a union. It's getting back to how it was. Because from the time all the unions were broken up, the fact now you've got 0 hours work contracts, they can sack you, you can't do anything about it. You're really just now more of a slave than you were in even ancient Rome. So these are the specifics. So acting now, stopping everything and joining. I mean, in a way, I don't care what you join. It's just we've got this idea, so let's go with this and see where it takes us. A membership drive to try and get people on. And it isn't for making money, and it's not for me to buy a canary-coloured Porsche and go and live off somewhere. The promissory notes aren't being sold to the Chinese. Various people know where they are. So it's all being looked after and taken care of on domestic soil. The main ingredients, though, the promissory notes and the checking facility, are the holy ground. Those are the things that will pin you to a success within this, as long as you become a little bit more aware and a bit more savvy of the arguments. But as it goes on, in the frequently answered questions, all the questions that are there, there's a section going to be created soon on the website for the banks. So the banks will be able to go in, look and see that the checks have been uploaded and have been cleared, and then it's up to them whether they take the money or not. And I said repeatedly to them, we are the banker's prayer. You should be very happy we came along, because only by us bringing this extra energy or money clearing facility in, can you clear your debt book and carry on moving? And I think, obviously, at some level, they're not that, well, they're not stupid because they've been running this this game for a long time. So, what we're looking at is the unit, or RE, we're going to recategorize it. Because at the moment, the big thing that's holding it back is it's a mind-based unit based on time. So people who are working and crediting on their accounts, the time-based element, are going, okay, well, fine, I've done that now, but where can I actually go and spend it? So up until we get the numbers up, and what we're doing is we're also going to put a map on the website so you can actually see the concentrations of people in your area. So you can tag up with them. But the next thing is, we've got a lot of people out there which are outside the sphere of influence. So it's okay you say, well, I'm quite happy to try this RE as a spending unit. But that painter there, he won't do the job for me, because though he might do the painting for free or for RE, he needs to buy the paint. And he's got to go out and buy that from someone else. Okay? So what we're going to do is, we're going to create the equivalent of a Swiss franc. So, I don't know, there's always been a history of the Swiss franc being quite an acceptable form of currency, and in times of economic and currency meltdown, it's always a refuge for people to go and buy Swiss francs. Why? Because they believe that the Swiss government will endure. It's a neutral country, and it's where the elite stash all their stolen goods. That's why it's allowed to survive. So, scrip just means something that's written. Yeah. So I've always said before that we weren't a bank involved in scrip. Yeah, because, you know, look at the amount of currency you'd have to have printing presses the size of the Bank of England and the Mint turning the wheels for the amounts that would be required. So, but what we're going to do is we're going to do it in a more limited way. This isn't going to happen next week or the week after, but it could be in a very, very short period of time, because we've got the technicians working on it now, and it's something that I was involved in 2010. I mentioned it before, Global Settlement Foundation. We're trying to bring a gold-backed unit of currency into Africa. And one of the main proponents was Muammar Gaddafi, with the Organization of African Unity. And this is what the idea was, that they were going to make a fast run for it and bring in this gold-backed unit. So there's a difference between gold-backed, which could be any variable percentage of gold, or it can be the next thing then, carrying the coin. So what we're looking at is charging a note, but not using coin, because notes are a lot more appealing. So we're going to also create a currency war. So there's a currency war already on the planet at the moment, between the dollar, the euro, the ruble, the renminbi, the yuan. And so they're battling all this out now between them to find out who the heads of the mafia-type Zionist cabal are going to be, who finally are in charge of the new world currency. And they'll be proposing various alternatives. But what we're going to do is we're going to have our own internal one, a two-tier. So there's everything that the unit of time was before, how you earned it, but now also there is going to be a gold-backed unit if this finds sufficient approval from the people. Okay, so what this involves is the club revaluing the price of gold. Okay, so we unilaterally, as the group, look at the price historically and look at what we think would be a reasonable level it should have been at now, but based on these historical facts, remember it stayed for over 200 years at the same rate. If we actually floated it up now, you would find that if we look at an eightfold revaluation of where it is now, and that's reasonably conservative, we come in at these figures, around about $6,000.
So what we're looking
to do then is create, well, the dollar is supposedly the reserve currency, a global reserve currency. So what we're going to do is create our own reserve currency. And the reason for it is to give it absolute bomb-proof spendability no matter what happens outside. So this is the key now. This is the key and what all this is sort of leading up to. A unique initiative to embrace new but ancient teachings. Okay? So there's lots of information, there's lots of knowledge out there that we've all been searching for, and there's lots of suppression, and virtually every single thing that you could imagine that we take as being the truth is not. We've all been systematically sort of lied to and steered away from the truth. So this is the idea, right? Instead of, we could say, for example, that you don't care what you pay the monthly subscription in over the year. So if we had it quarterly, yeah, £10 over 3, 4 times 3 is 12. So 120 over the year, however you want to cut it. Okay? So then what we look to do is to say, right, this is how we like to receive it. And you don't really care. We could say, right, we want a pair of Nike trainers sent in a box, or we want a suit sent in a box, or we want fruit sent, because you're taking your £10 a month or £30 over the 3 months and just doing something with it anyway. So what we are going to do is we'll say this is how we'd like to be paid, and you'll say, okay, that's nothing to me, 30 quid times 4 times a year was coming out my pocket anyway. What do I care what I do with it, right? So we, though, do something for you that comes in here. So it's a call to arms, it's an emergency action, and it's the first group that this has been floated in front of, and equally, just making sure of time here, it hasn't been covered anywhere else. This is not a new idea, but it only has come out by the fact that we're under this attack from the banking community, that if we just stay in the realm of the checking account, we're not going to be able to expand it, because they're coming along and saying, oh, it's not valid and we can't trade with what's called people outside the zone, or what you say, the circle of trust. So what we'll do is, the gram of gold at the moment is about £27 for a gram. Okay? And so the moment you throw it over to us by the factor of 8, it goes to 216 a gram. Okay? That's just that us unilaterally revaluing it and saying, this is what the price of gold is. Historically, in 1933, the Gold Confiscation Act by Roosevelt, they confiscated all the gold in the United States. I think it was then at something like 29 an ounce. That's what it was on the Friday. And on the Monday, when the market opened, they jumped it up to 33 and made a phenomenal amount of money for the United States Treasury, read the CIA and the banking organizations behind it. So what we've got then is, WeRe Bank creates the script or the note, and the notes become infused with the gold. So has anybody got a £10 on them, or a 20? Okay. Right, just a 10. So there's, if anyone's got them, you've got, this is a tenner. You see this little, there's like a little silver thing there. And all those are, if you actually look at it in the right light, you'll see there's like a little plastic thing around it. And they're put in under heat and pressure and welded onto the note. Okay? Equally, when you turn them over, there's that little the line that weaves back and forward. So the principle behind infusing the notes will be threefold. The moment the 1 gram arrives, it's 8 times the price in our club as it is outside. So you can see what it might want to do to people outside who want to secure currency. They'll want it. Yeah, I hope. Okay. They'll want it more than they'll want anything else. And just in case I forget. And why they'll want it is because for the first time since we were taken off the gold standard in 1931, it won't be exchangeable for gold. It will actually be. So the process now with the technology is to do what up until now wasn't doable, and that is either using gold leaf or gold flake.
You get out.
Yes! Gold leaf or gold flake into the note, or the next part, and we haven't worked out exactly at the moment the solution, actually, literally, is we take microparticles, not nanoparticles, microparticles of gold, we put them in the solution with the paper, and then dry the papers out, therefore the particles become infused in the note, and then the finishing treatment, anyone been to Australia or New Zealand in the last few years and seen their notes? You can go to the beach with them, you can put them in a washing machine. Yeah, so it's like a plastic, and it's really durable. Now, depending on which way we go, either with the little seal impregnated in, or the weave through, or the lettering going through the note, that will be a designated amount of point something something of a gram of 99% pure gold infused into the note. So the actual carrying mechanism becomes the value in itself. There's no question about it being gold backed. There's no argument about it's a coin. The only question then is the 2 points. In fact, the main one is really, but what's to stop somebody cheating me on it? With a coin, the big problem in the old days was what's called clipping. Yeah? Someone would shave the coin. Or they could counterfeit it by producing something like, I don't know, a lead plug, coating it over. And this is why you used to have this touchstone thing, you know, you'd get some gold and you'd rub it on and put some acid on. But you don't need this with the integrity of the product, because it'll be for the retailer or for people generally, it's very easy to do. And just like, you know, when you go into the supermarket or the bookies or wherever you go, if you give a high denomination note, or sometimes not even, they'll put it in the light and it'll show that it's a valid note. Well, they can do that with various very cheap ways of what's called spectroscopy for the actual note. So that's where that's going then. So the next part then is the re as a unit of time. How do we marry that up? So it becomes now that we had, and this is the proposal, before we had this unit which was 12 re per hour of work, which was equated to about £24. Yeah? So we've looked at that now, or I've looked at that and thought, right, well, if we take a re time units, so one is RET and one's REG. Yeah? If we link the one RE in gold to the one RE in time, it comes in at about 15. £15 for one. The idea is the time one is paid at 2 an hour. Therefore, for an 8-hour day, 16 RE, 240 for a day's work in gold. Yeah, real money, whoa, not artificial. Okay? So it's fair, it's equitable, available, radical. The IMF, World Bank, European Central Bank, the Fed, the Bank of England are all planning a gold-backed currency contingency. They've got it. Now, here's why we are doing it like this. I keep saying we. What they would say to us, and it's a typical argument, we've got the gun, but we ain't got no bullets to fire. Yeah? So this is the argument with all of you. Yeah? You've got the idea, yeah? But where's your gold? Yeah? You can't. So this is why the time unit was in. It was introduced. It cuts us completely away. But for the interim period, while we've got probably, let's hope, a 30-month run at it, we'll use our intelligence and our commitment, the new technology. We'll translate this old fuddy-duddy gold-backed nonsense, because I'm not a gold bug, I'm not a great lover of it, but if it gets us to where we need to go, and we can create, with the technology, a gold-backed unit, which isn't coins jangling in your pocket and you're having to worry too much about, yeah, we can have them in reasonably, very easily carryable sizes. They're tamper-proof, because you'd have to be a lunatic to try and get the particles out of it or the infusion out of it, because by the time you'd finished flicking at it and scratching it and ripping it, it would be all over the place, and why bother? Yeah? And equally, why bother? Because somebody might say, well, why, you know, you could just burn it, the notes, and you then collect the gold and... But why would you bother? You still got to carry it around anywhere, or then make sure that you're making it into a bigger and bigger piece. So why not just keep it in the note as it is, and that's it. So the idea is, while you've still got time, we're on the Titanic. Yeah? But this is in the ballroom when we're just setting float from, was it in Liverpool?
Yes.
And we're all happy and we're all great. Right. But someone has said to you, oh, White Star Line, maybe they want this thing sent into the bottom of the sea. And so I'm saying, that's what's going to happen. And you're all going to go, oh, don't be crazy, don't be stupid, we can't sink this. So what I'm trying to say is, this is our 30-month window. At no cost to you, other than the fact you're in the room now, and you like the idea of the checkbook or the checking facility, and the idea of the movement. So as long as it still all rings true, then we've got more ideas, and it's ideas that they haven't even thought of. So the plan, therefore, is we take the unit of currency while we can, we create our own gold-backed unit to run simultaneously with the time unit, and what will hopefully happen is they'll seamlessly interlink, because the utopian future is you just get rid of the gold backed anything. Because, to be quite honest, it's a bit, for a planet that's evolving, it's all a little bit, you know, king's crown and gold here and gold round the neck. If we could get away from that, we could run on the time based. But until we do, we've got to have this sort of, you could call it an IOU, International Outreach Unit, whereby what we can go to people and say, all right, yeah, all right, yeah, okay, you don't want to have that, but what about a few of these? What's that? Oh, yeah, it looks very nice. What's in it? Gold. Get out. And it will sweep through the country as the only way forward for people who want to protect themselves, because then we don't have to worry so much about so many numbers joining. What we're doing is, what will compensate for the numbers are the revaluation of the currency, of the gold price, into the fact we've got an easily transportable unit of currency. So I think that is that, apart from the advice. So join Re Movement. If you haven't got an envelope, take one. Please write your name, email, address, and account number legibly. The Re Movement, the joining fee, it's 35 1 month plus the setup fee to include the checkbooks. The checkbooks are coming down to 25 in number from 50 just because of the sheer numbers we've got to go out at the moment. So when and you want more checks, then you can come along and have those. Name and account number will now, not from now, but within the next month, you'll have your name and your account number printed on your checks. So that gives extra security for you, and it also addresses the good question from the chat gentleman before about can I pay my wife's, whatever it was. So we're trying to make it just so we've got this more of a personalised link for you, and it makes it a little bit safer for you because you've actually got your own name and your account number on it. Thereafter, this is the proposal. Well, isn't yet. Membership, 120 per annum or 30 quarterly, payable in gold, delivered to WeRe Bank. And one of the things I'd like to mention is the fact that I've been brought up always to believe that cash shouldn't be sent through the post. Yeah? But I was speaking to someone at the Royal Mail the other week, and they said, no, that's not the case. Actively, people do, and if you wish to, then you use this. Yeah? Plastic. First class, you've put anything in it of value. Up to 100 grams, it's insured up to £500. And evidently, it's outside the private jurisdiction of Royal Mail. It comes under UPU, evidently, whatever that means. So that's the thing to use. So for people who then are joining from you, the idea is, as you have to send your promissory note, you might as well put it in there and also put your contribution in, and cash isn't a problem for the moment, because until we can, and I can't see us ever doing it, by the way, now, the funds have got to come in either through the post or they've got to come in through meetings. And the good thing is, as we get bigger, it won't be so important. But until that point comes, we have to stretch out and do this. And while we'll make it easier, is we want lots of hubs or, there's going to be this one here, there's one in Liverpool, there's going to be one down the south, there's one already in Birmingham. And so we need more and more, and therefore you don't have to travel such great distances. We've also then, just before I forget, yes, I know there's so many ideas, what we're also now working at the same time as the note is we'll have the charge card. So you'll have your own card, and that will be charged up with Re units, which we spoke about before, and you'll be able to spend those in retail establishments. The retailer end won't need to be connected up by a dial-up like it is now, but he'll have a download every morning and he'll have an upload in the evening onto the box. A bit like if you travel on the trains, yeah? And you haven't paid your ticket, you have to pay your ticket. They're not connected up to the terminal. They've just got a list of unacceptable cards for the day. And if your card doesn't process, they go on the phone and try and clear it. So the idea will be then, we'll open it up to retailers, and that then brings in the spending ability for you to go in and they won't know or care whether you're spending gold-backed or time-backed, because it'll be charged with RE. So, is that reasonably clear? Okay, right. So that's about it for now. And what I'm going to do is just have a drink of water, and then we'll start with some questions. Can I just say thank you very much to you for doing this and making it all look so good. Thank you very much. So let's start with some questions. Quite a few have been asked already, but let's carry on now. So, that lady at the back there.
Oh, yeah. Can you give a noise down, guys, please?
Are you advising that we ask for a redemption statement paid off the stock in full or paid by check as a monthly instead of direct debit?
No. If you're going to look to pay off the mortgage, two things you need to consider. For some people, what's happening is when you're asking for a redemption figure, and then who to make the cheque payable to, they're saying to make it payable to yourself, to your own mortgage account, supposedly. But the stupidity of that, or the craziness of that, is that if it's yourself you're going to be paying, why would you actually be calling it in ever and want to pay it in the first place? So I would suggest that if it's they that have asked or given you the loan, then it's them you should be paying. So also, on the monthly amounts, if the cheque system works, and it does, whether they allow it to or whatever dust they kick up, then there's no point in going for it piecemeal, paying it monthly, because they can just mess you or dick you about monthly. So if you're going to pay it in one, and then you walk free. Okay, then this gentleman here is
just add something to that. I used to work in banking, and I know that they could easily accept a cheque made payable to themselves or the mortgage account, or themselves re the mortgage account. And the reason why they tell customers to put their own name on it is in case the cheque goes missing and they need to know who to apply it to. So you can easily just write down Lloyd's Bank or Halifax.
Right.
And not a problem.
Okay.
You can take it either way.
Thank you. That's a very good point, because when you actually look at the Bills of Exchange Act and the United Nations Convention, the United Nations Convention 1988, which refers to bills of exchange promissory notes, I think there's one part of that UN convention says this does not apply to cheques, which is a point. However, when you actually look at the draft legislation, you see that everyone that was discussing that before that piece of legislation was passed, saying it should refer to cheques, because they hypothesised that if it didn't apply to cheques, then what you were opening up is what's called a two-tier Bills of Exchange Act. Yeah, so it either is a promissory note, cheque, negotiable instrument, letter of credit, etc., or it isn't. So in many cases, it doesn't matter behind the scenes what happens to these cheques. Somebody could cut them in two, piece them back together again, the cat can wee on them, forge signature, doesn't matter. There's a whole range of facilities that they have to make sure they get paid on these things. And even to the extent in the old days, once a cheque had been acted upon, they would send it back for your accounts. So that actually puts sort of sleep to the proposition. Just because they're sending it back and saying it's no good doesn't mean they haven't already acted upon it and credited their account, and telling you, well, nothing's happened and it's no good, therefore keep on paying. So they're taking a double, well, then they're going for a triple bite at the cherry. Okay, well, the best way to answer that is that when we first started, the first week, when the checkbooks went out around the 17th of April, the week after, many banks were quite confrontational. Many council, should we say, bookkeeping departments were sort of openly hostile. I had NatWest legal department on the phone, HSBC legal department, a guy called John at a very senior level in NatWest London, in between asking, well, how does it work, or coming on the phone pretending that they're one of you, saying, oh, I just want some clarification. They, by degree, seemingly become, I wouldn't say more accepting, but they've actually started to communicate a little bit. A vast majority sort of phone, and then as soon as I answer, they hang up. A lot of coming back and just simply saying that the sort code isn't valid, or is this a, you know, it's not a valid bank. I had a conversation the other day with Halifax Building Society. This woman saying, I've got the client on the phone at the moment. She didn't tell me till the very end. So she was on for over 9 minutes, simply asking the same question all the time. Were we regulated by the FSA? Are you a regulated bank? Are you under the control of the Bank of England? Which is no. Then you can't be a bank. So I record all the conversations. In many instances, they're lying and saying to people, the check's been returned, refer to drawer. Or we've refused to clear it. Now, you know, why would we? So what we're doing in those instances is nailing them down, insist that they put that in writing, and just confirm the brief details. Who did you speak to? Roughly what day? Was it a man or a woman? Can you just clarify that, because it's of a concern to you. But for when they start... Oh, and Westpac in Australia turned a lady's check down recently and accused her of, various practices. And if you're trying to get money off Westpac Bank, especially under the guise of these checks that may have been sold to you by Richard of England. Richard of England and his lawful bank. He also goes under the name Roger Hayes. So they got almost within that 5 or 6 paragraphs every single thing wrong that you could possibly get wrong, by saying that it wasn't this and it wasn't that and it's unacceptable, and therefore accusing her if she persists in trying to get, you know, if it incurs a loss to Westpac Bank, or if it includes a gain for her, she's basically involved in some sort of fraudulent activity. And just so we clarify, fraud is a passing off. Yeah? That's trying to dupe somebody or convince them to take a form of action on the belief that what they're acting on is the genuine article. So that's a copying of a Monet picture, copying a Bank of England note, copying and making yourself look like this gentleman here, and then going into a bank pretending to be him. So no one can use that argument. If the sort code isn't recognised as being with any other bank in the UK, we've got the name and the address of where we're supposed to be. We don't have the account number on. It's just a load of all eights, which doesn't exist. So it's stretching credibility for them to start making accusations that it's fraudulent, or it's whatever else they want to say. So hopefully answers that question. This chap here.
So what exactly do we do if a check's not accepted?
Okay.
What do we do?
If the check is not accepted, there's two lines that it might not be accepted. The person that's the payee, so you make the check out and you send it to the local council and they send it straight back to you, and there's nothing written on the check at all. Okay, so what you've done then is you make the, you're basically looking then for the sections under the refusal for acceptance or refusal to present. So it's exactly the same whether they do it Or if they then put it into the bank, and the bank then come back and they say they've refused it, can you send another form of payment? So it's still those section 42 and 43, and then
of the bills of exchange act.
Yeah, then you're making that notarial protest. So what you should possibly do, if it's the local council, if it's Virgin Media, or if it's the payee directly that's saying it's no good, then what I would say to them is, it's not up to them to decide, they must present it for clearing. And this is the thing, UK clearing is only a preference of the main commercial high street banks. The only people that can verify that there are funds in the account is the bank that it's drawn on, or the drawee. So they must present it to us. And they can either do it over the phone, electronically, under what's called the Deregulation Bills of Exchange Act 1996, which is a statutory instrument. I think that's sections, I think that's 72 and 73. Alternative place of presentment and alternative means of presentment. So all we want over the phone is several things, like RBS phoned up on Friday. Could I confirm? And then, well, it's RBS Lloyds, I think, in Scotland. And they said, well, yeah, can you confirm? And I said, we just need the four pieces or five pieces. The date of the check, the amount, the name of the person, the check number, and I think one other. And you can clear it over the phone. Now, if they're prepared to play that game, it's much easier for them. Eventually, we'll have a section on the website where they can go in and look. But other than that, it's very simple. The system is either sound or it isn't. There's no fudging it. It's no skipping and hopping and jumping and then putting your finger in your ear because you forgot to do it at the beginning. Their system states quite specifically that if it's a check on its face that looks good, then if there is money, however defined, in the account to back it, then they must accept it. And if they don't accept it, they need to say why, dishonour, tilt, finish. And if they refuse to present it equally, the same thing. Because presenting it to us is then the clarification to them that there is money available. And their way is 98% of all money is what's called bank book, checkbook, ledger, monetary unit of account, which is just the simple debiting of a fictitious ledger here and crediting of a fictitious ledger there. Okay,
that chap there with his hand
up. Okay, so it's a recap on what the checks can be used for and what they can't be. Probably the best way to refer it as a debt checking facility or a debt checking service. The whole rationale from day one, it's on the front of the website, states that we are predominantly looking to facilitate this alleviation of debt and this encroachment of this this credit society that we've all been sort of scooped up in. So it's primarily for arrears or debts or people that need a last resort because either their homes are in dire straits of being possessed or repossessed, that the credit card accounts are going to end up taking them into a county court, or their businesses are going to be bankrupted because of non-payment of VAT, or there are fines accumulating because of non-payment of self-assessment, etc. So anything on the public side. A public side does include all the banks, all the councils, all the car finance companies, all the insurance related matters, because it's all part of the same web with the same spider. So they are not to be used, for example, like someone recently did with his his Barclay card. He usually has £500 to £600 a month to pay off on it, but this particular month he didn't. He had £19 something in. So he sends a check for £19.08, sees that it's cleared, and then finds out they closed his card account. you know? So, but he didn't need to do that, you know? It would have been much better if he'd have done it in a month when he owed 500. So the idea is that once you do that, don't forget, these are the this is the opponent that you're dealing with. You can't expect the high street banks, under which we are, as I say, we are assailing them with their own ropes. You can't expect them to be nice and shall we say, kindly to us, and expect all the same services before. If you're suddenly paying down your credit card and they're clearing it, let's say, and then the next Saturday you're going out and racking up £400 or £500 in Pizza Express and TGF in Covent Garden. You know, it's sort of like taking the piss a little bit. So the main guidance is that when you're in the position where your back's against the wall and you're just about either to be taken to court or you have your home taken from you, or, you know, parking fines, which are just like, you know, £83 because you didn't buy a £1.50 ticket, then forget them, you know. They statutorily do not have a leg to stand on. But instead of going and fighting the whole thing, just pay it. So hopefully that answers that.
Pizza Hallam.
Yeah, just for clarity, when somebody's joining WeRe Bank, if they call Bob Smith, do they put Bob Smith or do they put Robert Smith?
Probably what's over on your birth certificate or your national insurance. So if you're called Robert, if you were called Robert, is this for the account number?
Not so much for that, but it's for details on the phone when you join.
Yeah, it's a good point. I'm speechless. I don't know the answer to that question.
The name of your birth certificate and your passport, that's it.
Yeah, so keep it what's on your birth certificate, or stay with your birth certificate, because we're operating, don't forget, there's two things we've done here. We've split your personality and we've created two personae. You're on the public side to stick it to them on the public, and all this other, the re, is on now the private side. So, you know, so if we're paying down the sterling on that sterling side, that's all public since 1931 when you were the means of payment was taken away from you. So everything from then on is legitimate. Yeah, when we came off the gold act, when we came off the gold standard between sort of 29 and then 27 and 31. So that's why this is legitimate, because they promised you a line of credit from that point, and they were going to issue that through the Bank of England, but you never got it, you know? So in effect, they're at war with you, and you're there to pay off the national debt as they run it up on lovely shopping malls and crystals on the road in the cat's eyes, or, you know, a 5.5 million technical college that's been built up by, you know, their mates on the council, and so you're expected to pay for it. So public side, private side, a bit of schizophrenia involved and wearing two hats. When you put that hat on, you're that persona. When you're the other, like, everyone in here is acting now in private. You do whatever you want. You know, if you want to exchange, you know, this for oranges, you can do. It's just, it's our private. But once you get into the public domain, and this is the thing, they are telling you, no more checks. You can't pay, you can only pay with a card. You can't pay with cash. You must do this. You must not park on there. It's all just one way. It's all coming at you, and it's all running downhill. Okay, this chap here.
Everyone in here must know what's going on with John Harris last week.
Dead, isn't he?
Yes. What security? People have died for less than what you're doing now. What security?
What did he die of? Do we know?
Huh?
What did he die of?
Suicide.
Yeah, well, all like, so.
Publicity.
Are you protected? Are you okay?
Publicity.
Yeah.
If they take him out and pretend takes his place, that is the defence.
Yeah.
I don't know.
No, I'd like to think so, but historically, Adolf Hitler said it in Mein Kampf, that the degree of heroism is always related to the degree of risk. So I'm not a great favourite of Adolf. But everybody should read Mein Kampf and find out the mindset. It's banned in certain countries.
Yeah, but it's a security
service. Yeah, yeah, yeah. No. What people have got to remember here, and this whole thing is predicated on, let's call it a hierarchy of beings that are interested in solving this problem. On the argument that, not that you propose, but the argument that states something could happen means you would never do anything. They've already won. So they've already won, but therefore you can't really march to that tune because, one, then they've already won. You know, when I went into the Peter of England thing with the number plates, so many people said to me on that first day, well, I'll give you till you get to junction 15 on the M6 before they pulled you over. 2 months later, I was still driving around. It was only my own stupid fault driving into Stansted Airport with a camping car, going through the barrier to drop my girlfriend off, seeing how much it was to pay, something like 15 quid for... So I didn't have enough money, and then trying to get out, and the security people having to get the gate up for me, which possibly triggered it. And the problem is, we shouldn't have been going to that airport, so this is just a thing now. We told the person to book the flight from Gatwick, because they found out where the cheaper flights were. When they said to us, right, we've booked the flight for the time and date, okay. Oh, she pressed the wrong button at the end and it was from Stansted. So the only reason we ever ended up in Stansted was a mistake, because otherwise the camping car would have been parked, we'd have gone in on the train, and I'd have been off and out and another chapter would have carried on. So it's who and why these acts of fate happen. And then there's also this thing called destiny. So I'm a believer in a very strong protection, and it's just something that I know, and the last thing they want probably is me in their mouth, you know, and having to spit it out. So it's a good point, but we'll see. History will prove who was right and who was wrong. And as I keep saying, as long as I'm still standing here doing this, then the problem lies to their side, and we will march down, and I have a commitment to change it, which is incarnational eons in the build-up. And so there are lots of people, there are not only people behind the scenes wanting this to happen on both sides of the camp, but also, should we say, extraterrestrially, that have an interest in it. And that's the protection, because if you're relying on a truncheon or a protective armour or a bodyguard, forget it. The Tibetans know of these energy paths, the Hindus. Anyway, so that's the direction it's coming in, and that's what will sustain it. And it's a belief. And don't forget, it's the belief in you that projects into here, which then projects back. So eventually, you know, we could end up doing some quite miraculous things when we eventually start using our minds to do this, because a lot of mind experiments have been successfully showing of what you can and can't do with directed energy. So that's that one. Okay, that chap there.
Yeah. Can you credit your account with work previously done?
Over what period of time?
Well, I work for the fire service, so I've worked for them 26 years.
Yes, I do believe that facility, but I'll have to tread a little bit carefully on it, because I wouldn't like you to load in 26 years worth now. But the belief on that is the following. If we're actually looking, for example, to charge your accounts with now, for example, from the time you signed the promissory note, I would have to say from now on, because what's gone is possibly gone. However, let's look at someone who's 88. He just joined, and he can't contribute because he's only on a pension and doesn't have any savings. Let's look at what historically and ancestrally that person has been ripped off to the tune of over his complete life of work. And don't forget, one of the preemptive points in WeRe Bank's ideology is you are now sitting, you're the last electron on the point of the pinhead. And everything behind there is those that went before you, that died in the cold, didn't have medical treatment, didn't have money, lying in flea-ridden beds in London in the 17th, 18th, the whole pot, all the people who were exploited historically. And I've probably been quite involved in doing it in the past, as we all have, I'm sure. But, so there comes a point now where you look at that, and that is therefore you, and what is therefore, you are the custodians of the global collateral accounts. So the planet isn't owned by anybody, it's owned by all of us. So everything on it is owned by all of us. So it's not a utopian, socialistic, communist ideal, it's logic. So loading the hours for someone is something that we do encourage, or we can, and it's all to do with the fact how much you've been ripped off, but we can't do it erratically, and we have to put a mechanism in it to get you like there, because the 88-year-old is just as important as this young person here, who's about, what, 8?
12.
There you go, because he's all curled up. Okay, so a question here.
Hiya, Peter. At 150 people in this room,
yeah.
You know, at £30, if they put £30 in the envelope,
yeah.
Are you going to be, and if you keep doing this, are you going to be on a Caribbean island?
Yes, I am. That is the plan.
You know, it's just, hang on, a question.
No.
It's just a question.
It's a very good question. So, I'll answer that.
I just want you to make me believe.
Right. Okay, so, have you listened to any of my YouTube videos in the past?
Yeah, okay. No, I haven't, sorry, no, just today.
Okay, and so, what I've done since, well, quite a long time ago, but since 2012 is really, it's almost like you could say, not setting the scene, but I've been out there trying to preach some type of gospel. And the way I've done it and the things I've done have been filmed. And the statements that I've made have been recorded by me and others. And so I'd actually say that there are a lot easier ways, maybe, think of getting 35 quids. I used to trade on the stock market, for example. I don't know whether many people know. I was a full-time derivatives trader. I used to make 12% return a month. Yeah, and that's verified by the accountants and also by the Daily Mail, who used to run my ad. And it used to say, 3 trades, 3 months, 300% return or your money back.
Why did you stop then?
Because I realised that it was a very pernicious and toxic environment to be operating in, because you're only ever taking from people. And I had, shall we say, this was about 2000, 2001, should we say, a spiritual awakening, which had come from the death of my father in 1996. So, there are easier ways for me. I mean, I could sit down now and it would be much easier for me to do two scams. Let's start some sort of gold club. That would be a classic, but that's never come till now. Or the other one would be, we go and do some type of investment club where I show you how to put derivatives onto the market and how to trade it, right? But it's something that was a necessary thing for me to go through and learn, because it's what brings the knowledge now. But, you know, I lost something like, one day I lost over about, I don't know, I think it was about 45,000, and I could hardly walk for a week, you know, and it was an immediate, it was like one hand of cards, gone. So I came back from it, and then I rebuilt it in a different way, because I couldn't leave when I was quitting. So I'm not here to go and live on an island anywhere. I live very frugally. I lived for nearly 6 years in a camping car. The whole history of this is a very, it's a quite a sad story. So I wouldn't go into it because I'm in the strict instructions by someone not to go into it because it's all a bit, yeah. So that's the point. And ultimately, you can only recognize the truth. You can't be taught it. You can't be forced on it. And for everyone that says, oh, you know, it's a bullshit type scam and I'm going to get a banana coloured Porsche, you know, really what? And trick everybody.
Can I just contribute to that? The reason they're bringing these guys to the meetings, like the Ashton meeting, other meetings around the country, right? Instead of some name on the internet, right? You can look in his eyes. And the best way of judging somebody, my way, is to look in their eyes. So
the only way, really, is.
Yeah, exactly.
Years.
And you know, also, you're not wrong because you haven't actually said really what you. And here's the thing, this is the great problem with you and us. We're all here now, and really, I'd say probably, let's say there's 20% of the room who are, 40% who are very committed. Then there's 20 to 30% that are not so sure, and then there's some people towards the end, and at the end. If it went wrong, they go, yeah, I always thought it was a bit too good to be true. Now, the commitment on the other side is so ironclad that they won't even bring up a topic like that, you know, within their own ranks. And that's why they manage to get done what they get done. There's no falling out of bed and going, oh, I'm not sure whether I want to do that. They're told what to do. They're told through the Bilderberg meetings, etc., this is the implementation. You're for Volvo, that's Fiat, that's Smith Klein Beecham, there's the pharmaceuticals, there's the food additives. We want that in place within 1 month, go. Here's the HS2, we want that put in the UK. Okay, right, consider it done. There's no coming back with excuses and thinking, oh, well, I'm not so sure whether it's a good idea. They have to do it. And so this is our problem, that if we embraced it all, without hesitation, and just took a punt that look at what's the worst thing that could happen, we'd be home and dry within by my birthday in October. But it won't happen because people will wait. And with you, you go and talk to 5 or 6 people, they'll all be suspicious and they'll all go until when it eventually breaks, like every revolution or all the people who were in the resistance in France from 39 to 45, as my dad used to say, oh yeah, you know, we didn't see too many when we were over there, but when the war was finished, the whole country had been in the resistance. Yeah, but that's just nature of people. They'll always hang back and wait and wait, and I'm not saying it's wrong, but it's how it's historically always been, and that's why every innovation, every, shall we say, major piece of progressive social reform has always ever come from the individual, could be you or you or you, never from a group, you know, Alexander the Great or Taras Bulba or Stalin or Hitler or Pol Pot, oh no, I shouldn't mention too many of those, but that's where it's all happened. It's always that individual that needs to lift it, and the faster, you know, the slower you go up through it, I always think it's like a pen going up through a custard skin. If you go up too fast, you don't take much with you. But if you go very, very gently, yeah, you can almost lift the entire. So maybe sometimes that's why these things are best grown slow, because if they go high fast, they'll probably burst fast. Hopefully that answers that one.
Right. Notorious process, a quick one. How long do we actually get? Because I've looked through Red Hills Exchange, I'm still not clear with it.
Okay, this notorious protest is actually, I think it's section 93. So what it says is that you should make a notarial protest within 3 days.
What if you don't receive it within 3 days? That's my problem.
Well, it's whenever you receive it, right, or it is made known to you. Right. If it's over the phone these days, because in 1882 they didn't have phones, did they? Probably do. And also it actually says there that if you just note it for protest, that is as good as the protest, as long as you do protest it. So the idea of the protesting is really just to protest it and close it out then. But I'm not saying you shouldn't, you know, if the... if it's probably much easier to do if the payee sends it back.
Well, they have to send the check back.
Then, did they send it to the bank, though?
No, it was the bank that sent it to me. And what they've done is it's Chapman Gloucester. I've got the redemption off the Lloyds. They've turned around and said, right, write the check out to Lloyds and the account number. Then they've sent me a thing saying, you haven't got, it's not registered in the UK. Mm. And then they've asked me to send it to the C&G and my name.
Yeah, because it's a good point. You see, what they do, they don't actually know what to do with the things. And so they say, send it to here, send it to there. For example, the other day I had Close Brothers Auto on the phone. There was a check there for, I don't know, $4,500 to pay off some finance agreement. And she said that their local, that they bank with RBS, but RBS is something like, I don't know, 20 miles away. So they usually put all their checks through NatWest. So they put it into NatWest, and NatWest has sent it back to them saying they won't process it because they don't bank with them, they only clear through them, and they'll charge them £15 for processing. So otherwise, they've got to send it through to RBS. So she was phoning me saying, well, can you have a word with NatWest? You know, so otherwise you're going to have to charge the customer. And so... you know, they're in possession of these things. That, can you imagine? It's a quite a tight knit organisation. They've probably got a check up on every computer screen and every council office going. Anyway, so hopefully answers that. Yeah.
Are we drawing down when we make payments? Checks out. Are we drawing down from the promissory note? Are we drawing down from our energy going into our account?
You're actually drawing down. So the question is, when you write checks, what are you drawing down from? You're drawing down from the money created by your own bank within WeRe Bank. So your account is in effect your bank.
Yes.
So it's like an onion skin. So WeRe Bank is the onion, and all your layers are your banks. So when you sign the check for, say, 40,000 or 20 or whatever it is, that's drawing down on your energy promise of the 150 until it gets down to a stage where, let's say, you'd signed checks to the full extent and they've been cleared,
yes.
And therefore, typically over a 10-year period, you need to raise that back up till it's zero.
Can we put in a second promissory note if we've got two mortgages?
At the moment, we don't go down the second promissory note, even though some people have done even as many as 10, because what it does is it makes... Look at the logic of what we're trying to do, and... if the bank are saying anything untoward about us, imagine having to justify this. Oh, well, okay, so you took, like, what you gave this person you didn't even know, who's saying that they could do X, Y, Z, and what, you've given the best part of 1.5 million just on tip. How are they ever going to pay it off? So we have to. That's why it was done at about 150, because we thought most people over a 10-year period, you know, if you're earning 20, 25,000 a year, which we're allowing you to put your normal contribution from your job in to pay it down. So the bank is an agent. Is everybody aware of that?
Yes.
Yeah. So we are acting as your employer, like an agency, like a Deco or Blue Arrow. So. We're charging out, or they're, like Blue Arrow, they charge 14 quid an hour and pay you 7. So if you're earning 25 grand a year, we're saying you should be worth 50 grand a year. You're keeping your 25, the other 25 that you're the 25 you're notionally getting, we're saying credit into to pay down your promissory note.
Okay.
And also then, when you do stuff that's on the private side, but you couldn't get paid for any other way, then those units are added to your 148.
Okay.
And then there are other things you can do. You can then eventually start spending off the 148. But that's only when we get the retail element going and the cards.
The other question, gentleman over there from the bank said that they do accept with regard to mortgages. My question is, can we use the cheques to pay off our overdraft at the bank? Sort of a current account overdraft.
Yeah, anything. You've got to remember that anything from the banks is higher than the government in degree of corruption and entrapment. So you go, don't forget that governments require funding and banks pay to install governments. You then come under the government with a socially implied contract to pay taxes in return for voting rights. This is this sort of implied social deal. So that means anything on the public side, which seems to be private, aren't private at all. It's like privateers who used to raid ships as, not pirates, but privateers with a letter of marque issued by the government to cause trouble to the enemy. So that's what you've got. So anything on the public side, which is banks, insurance companies, HMRC, courts, fines, the whole thing, parking tickets, police, everything that's operating on that side, in effect, is fair game. Okay, this chap.
Hello. I've got loads and loads of questions, but one thing that's concerning me is you need credibility. I'm listening to people in here who are saying, I've sent a check off, they've done this, what do I do? That, to me, should not be happening. If you are sending a check off and you have a checkbook in your hand,
yeah,
it's all right coming up here just signing these things, getting a checkbook, and then they're going off paying stuff. You should know before you ever got that checkbook exactly what you're supposed to do if anything goes wrong, not be turning up to a meeting going, what do I do? I don't know what to do.
Okay.
This is madness to me that it. This needs to be an awful lot tighter than this.
It's a good point. Did everybody sort of hear that? He said,
no.
Okay, what he was basically saying is that people shouldn't be coming up here so much now and asking, well, what do I do when this happens? I've signed a check, I've sent it off, and this has happened, what happens next? Is that sort of...
Yeah, that's madness to me.
That's
that.
In effect.
Not being responsible, that's not being an adult.
Okay, right, so the point is, it's very true. And what he's saying is, and what we're trying to do is various things here. We are trying to make people understand the nature of money. We're trying to show them also behind the screen how the system works. We are trying to then get them to load up their own information on the website to, once they've written a check, now they have to post it and upload it and enter it in. We also then have the section. So it's all coming bit by bit, but we couldn't do it at the beginning because until about 3 weeks ago, WeRe Bank was me in a little room no bigger than here with a fold-up bed and my bag at the side. So I did all the, you know, got the checkbooks ready, was doing the mailing, answering the phone, the whole thing. And if we'd have waited, I assure you, if I'd have waited to get either numbers of people on board, everyone would have said, you've got to be mad to try that. Don't do it until you've got this. Let's try and find a backer. Yeah? Let's make sure this is happening and that. So it was really a case of throwing the eggs against the wall, and now we're here. Mm-hmm. And so we will be able to tighten it up. We will be able to bring sort of more balance into it. But predominantly, yes, there's a lot of crazy people out there. There's some guy on YouTube, one video he did a few weeks ago, quite funny. He says, I've got this checkbook here from WeRe Bank. He says, it came within 2 days or 3 days. Can't even remember why I ordered it now. I've got no debt and I don't quite know what to do with it. There's another guy, let's just call him Richie for now. He's on the phone 3 times a day. What should I do with this checkbook now? I said, well, what do you want to do, Richie? He says, I haven't got any debt. And he says, but I want to get in some debt so I can get out of it.
Can I just say something? Listen, guys, I just say, right, the free movement, free man movement, sovereign movement, whatever it is you want to do, right, we're basing upon honour, right? To be free man, we're not children, we're not infants, right? We're acting as adults, right? You must, you're wielding a lot of power, right? Anyone abuses it, I hope you burn in hell. Because there's people out there just now dying because of debt. I've known six people in the last 3 years kill themselves through debt, yeah? This is not a game. This is not as you can go off and buy yourself a new car, a holiday in the sun, right? That's beneath contempt, right? This is about, bills of exchange are all about zeroing out debt. That's all you're doing, right? If you can do that, if you, with your the power you have, can do something, can contribute to the wider world, help other people with their debts, show people how to do this, right? It's all about us helping each other, right? All it takes is there's some lunatics out there, some criminals out there, there's some bad people out there who will use this and to move for everyone. Just remember that one word. Once you start playing this game, honour. You must not only just talk about it, you must demonstrate honour. Yeah? There's infants out there. How we deal with them will transpire.
Peter.
Yeah, okay.
If we can put checks through you, if we want to present checks, if you're acting as a sort of bank and we want to utilise it, we often receive checks. How about sending them through you?
Yeah, it's a good point because last week I received three money orders from people in Canada for about 149 sterling for each one, and they're all made out to WeRe Bank. So there's a bit of a dilemma, but only at the beginning. And the dilemma is, well, what I could do is I could now credit those into the WeRe Bank account as anything. But at the initial stage, it's the only thing we need is sterling to do what we can't do until we can do with our unit. Yeah?
Yeah?
So this is the paradox of what's this guy doing, you know? Sometimes he's got a bank, or he set up this bank for people to pay off the public debt with the private side, but at the same time they're asking for sterling contributions. Because all the stuff out there that we need sterling for, and don't forget, there's not so much, I think last week, after the Nottingham meeting, I think there was probably that meeting, just so that everybody knows, I think there was about £1,700 generated at that meeting. Okay? I spent over, I think, £800 the following week in printing costs, paying for the IT support, trips from where I was to Liverpool, a trip to Manchester. I don't have a car, by the way. I don't have a car. So I go everywhere on the train. So it's those things, just to let people... I don't have a credit card either, so it has to be cash. So the point is, what's the point?
Yeah, it wasn't like that. It was just if the WeRe Bank, if we were users of the bank,
yeah.
Obviously, you know, we all get checks from different people at some time or other, and if we can use the WeRe Bank instead of the other bank.
Yeah, it's something that will come, but at the moment we're too embryonic, you know. We're not walking, but we're going to walk. And this is why we've got to escalate it and quickly. Okay, next, again, Fireman.
Sort of a combination of get out of debt free question is, I've gone through the process with them sending the three letters, but with the tagline that we've got here, just pay ahead.
Yeah.
Should I, even though I've gone through the process and I seem to be sort of out the other end, should I now pay the debt off or not? It's done and...
Well, no, what I would do is go the way you've been going. That could work, and it hopefully will.
Yeah.
But if it doesn't, then just whack it with this.
Right. Okay.
And then just so that we know, I'll just answer this question for everyone. There's still only two people really involved on the day-to-day issues. I'm sort of operating at the front end. That's fielding the phone, doing the questions on technicalities with the banks and all of that, and then there's someone, one other person, who works a full-time job at the back end, sorting out all the mistakes on the promissory notes, getting it all loaded up, making sure that the data's gone in, 150 tickets a day may be generated, that why can't I log in? Why can't I? How do I join WeRe Bank? So...
You can't use that time, month's time, to do that for you, because people are writing down their time.
Yeah, absolutely we can, but the problem is at the moment, you know, he's down in Gloucester Way, I'm up in sort of... See ya, Doncaster Way. Thank you, huh? See you soon. Thank you. And so I think that's probably about it. So then maybe the final question, and then that's enough for me talking for a day. Yeah.
Peter, so when we pay with these checks, what if the finance companies have got secured a charging order on the property? How is that going to be?
Yeah. So that the question is if there's a charging order on your property, we can't ever make anyone do what they won't do. For example, somebody could pay off their mortgage, let's say they actually clear it, but what we can't do is we can't get the mortgage company to contact the land registry to force them to put, you know, whatever they need to do on the title deed.
Yeah?
Huh?
Sounds a bit strange.
Yeah, so you would do it if you could, if you go that way, but what I'm saying is,
we... You just mentioned something about the land registry.
So what you just said is if you have any dealings with the land registry, don't address yourself as Mr. or Mrs. this, call yourself the principal.
If you're doing something that's important.
If you're doing something that's important, not just phoning up to find out, you know, something general. So, thank you for that, and that's about it again. Thank you.